Happening is in the annals of history, at least in Europe and especially this barely registers as a hiccup. Distinguished British historian, now I'm sure deceased, J.H. Plum, who wrote what was regarded as the definitive introduction to Great Britain in the 19th century. I guess for the title of his book was A History of Great Britain in the 19th Century. It was about 350 pages long, and he devoted all of one page to the War of 1812. I think it's a fair indication of what Great Britain thought about this conflict. It's not much. It was more of an inconvenience, a distraction, but not a big deal. In fact, probably the only country in the world that thinks this was a really big deal is Canada, because it's about the only time that the Canadians can claim that they actually defeated the United States in battle a couple of times. And if you ever visit Canada, some of their military installations, it seems to be a point that they constantly like to rub in your face if they find out that you're an American. That's the only country in the world I know that is still fighting a war that ended 200 years ago and no one else thinks it's important. Not even Americans. But there are some results that come out of this conflict in the War of 1812. The first is we're not going to have any more impressments. Great Britain is not going to touch American sailors on the high seas. There's not going to be no more impressments, no more kidnapping of American sailors. Second, no more British soldiers on U.S. soil. They are gone. They're off British. They're off all American soil. And third, there's not going to be any more interference with American shipping on the high seas. This is going to remain constant for the next 99 years. Now, when World War I breaks out in 1914, we're going to have some delicate episodes with Great Britain concerning trade relations with Imperial Germany. We'll talk about that in a little more detail when we get in the second semester. But even then, Great Britain is going to be very careful not to antagonize the United States of America. So we can say that at least from the War of 1812, we may have achieved some unintended or some desired, albeit less aggressively pursued, the consequences of this war. No more kidnapping, no more British soldiers on U.S. soil, no more interference with American trade. For European nations in particular, they recognize that for the second time in less than 50 years, the United States of America has taken on the most powerful nation in the world for the second time, and we didn't lose. Obviously, this is a country that has some stability, we have some roots, we have some credibility, and now essentially Europeans are going to pay attention to what's going on this side of the Atlantic. The United States speaks, people will at least listen. They may not recognize us as a world power, we're certainly not a world power, but we're a country to be recognized. What are the consequences of the United States?
How do they have such a great economy if they're a relatively small country compared to others like Russia or the United States? Did they draw troops from the colonies or?
No, they drew them from their own resources, and they've never had a very large standing army. I think the most troops that they ever had under arms probably was during the time of the Napoleonic War, but even then they're not fielding more than say 60 or 70,000 men. And the number's not going to go up very high. When World War I breaks out, the entire British Army consisted of 100,000 men, and they were spread all over the globe. Great Britain traditionally has a very small army. They're very dependent upon their navy for their national defense. So at this time, during the Napoleonic Wars, maybe 60,000 men. And most of those, of course, during the Napoleonic Wars, most of those guys could be in Europe or somewhere in the vicinity of England. Very few would be overseas. When we talk about British soldiers dominating, say, colonies overseas, we're talking about isolated trade stations in Africa and in Asia. And we're dealing with the people that are not as technologically advanced as European nations. I talk about this when I did my class in American military history, but technology European dominance over the rest of the world for 17th, 18th, 19th, and even into the 20th century. We have the technology, they don't. And so, you know, 100 British soldiers in India can control thousands of Indians from the subcontinent of India because they've got muskets. We've got muskets. The British have muskets. The Indians, they got spears and arrows. It's just that technological edge. This is going to explain in large measure why Americans could dominate the Indians. We have the technology to take it. Quite honestly, you can carry that argument even into the 21st century. The United States of America has got these sophisticated technological weapons, and that's how you really have a relatively small number of men and women in the armed forces today. Well, as a result, for the United States, when the War of 1812 comes to an end, the Federalists are going to look like spoilers. They're going to look like children having a little hissy fit because they didn't get their way. Remember what happens is the Federalists meet at the Hartford Convention. They're calling for an immediate end to this conflict. They're calling for some constitutional amendments to limit federal authority. They're calling for peace with Great Britain. At the very time that we're already negotiating a peace treaty, which is going to become the Treaty of Ghent, in 1814. The war comes to an end in 1815. Shooting war is over. The Federalists are going to look like spoilers and all this. This is really going to be the end of the Federalist Party as a national political party. They will field a national political candidate for president in 1816, but everybody expects him. He does. By 1820, the Federalists can't even bring out a national political candidate. It's in the indecisive military operations clearly demonstrated to just about everybody in the government that the next time we go to war, we better be ready. This was very embarrassing when we started this conflict in 1812. We weren't ready for this. And what's going to happen is not coincidentally, 30 years later, we take on Mexico, we're going to be ready for this fight. And it will explain in large measure why we just whipped the Mexicans very quickly in a little more than 1 year, which is a phenomenal achievement. We fought the most important, most powerful empire in the world for the second time, and we didn't lose. If we didn't lose, what do we conclude being Americans? We won, great in second. We won. We didn't lose, therefore we won. This is when you guys get a C on your test, and you go home and you tell mom and dad, I pass. And what do your parents think? I have the most brilliant child in Trinity Christian School because they aced the test. You didn't tell them that, but they concluded it, right? Because they're Americans. Got it? This is just the way Americans think. We didn't lose, therefore we must have won. Now, I know it sounds silly, but please keep this in mind, because if we didn't lose, we won. This is going to color all of our sentiments in U.S. foreign policy and even in our domestic affairs after the War of 1812. We're feeling pretty good about ourselves. You know, we aced the test. We are cool. We really didn't, but we convinced ourselves. We read our own propaganda, and we believe it. We're going to get some new national political figures that are going to enter the stage. This is the end of the Founding Fathers, the period of time. They've all died off. They're all living in an assisted care facility. They're all munching on watered-down oatmeal. Yeah, they're older than me. They're out of the game. And so we're going to have some new leaders that are going to take us into the period of time that I refer to as the antebellum period. Antebellum comes from the Latin, it means ante, before, bellum, war, before the war. What's the war that you're referring to? Which one? Civil. We are now getting in this period of time of the, what is referred to as the antebellum era or the antebellum period. From 1816 to 1860, everything that's going to be happening is going to be colored by sectional conflict between the North and the South. Yes, ma'am. 1816 to 1860. So these are the initial leaders that are going to come on to the political or the national political stage. John Quincy Adams, son of John Adams, John Quincy Adams, who later on is going to become Secretary of State and President of the United States. Andrew Jackson, a successful general during the War of 1812, an Indian fighter, and he too is going to become President of the United States. Henry Clay, a very prominent American statesman, who will serve as Speaker of the House of Representatives and a long-serving senator from Kentucky. He'll be a presidential contender four times. He will never get the prize, and will sadly die embittered from that experience. Yes, ma'am.
In the election of 1832, Andrew Jackson beat Henry Clay. What?
Well, we know what Sophie's presidential election was.
That was good.
I just knew it.
Scott, Winfield Scott enlisted in the United States Army in 1812 as a private. 3 years later, he was a major general in the United States Army. Stayed on in the United States Army and served until late in 1861, actually for the first 6 months of the American Civil War. He was the commanding general. Rather old then, I'm talking about a 40 plus career in uniform. Winfield Scott will try to become president of the United States twice and will fail twice. William Henry Harrison of Indiana, son of Benjamin Harrison, a signer of the Declaration of Independence and the fourth governor of Virginia. William Henry Harrison, a distinguished military career and a modest political career, he too will become president. William Henry Harrison has the dubious, who did William Henry Harrison? Audrey, do you remember him?
Yeah.
He has two distinguished characteristics as president.
He won't hate himself,
like
his political party
with the Whigs.
Okay. Is that what time you want
to know? Well, he has the distinction of having the shortest term in office. Served only 30 days.
30 days. Hey, and then his vice president came over.
Oh, wait, exactly. Who was that?
William Henry Harrison.
That's
served
right.
Only 30 days. He, like the weather we had yesterday morning, he insisted on standing outside the Capitol steps. Deliver his inaugural address without wearing a cap or a coat. And he got a terrible cold as a result of this, and the cold turned into pneumonia, and he died within 30 days.
How long was his speech?
2 hours.
Oh, my goodness.
That's the other point. He has the dubious distinction of also having delivered the longest presidential address in presidential history.
That's so long.
Actually, the question you should ask is, who in their right mind stands out in weather like we had yesterday morning for 2 hours listening to some guy talk?
We did that yesterday!
Thanks, sir.
Hope it's not for you.
No, I don't think you have to be out there for a few minutes of time. You have to go in and ride off and no mud. Okay, so that's William Henry. John C. Calhoun of South Carolina, distinguished statesman. He'll serve briefly as Vice President of the United States. Well, that takes us to the end of the War of 1812. Where we're going to go from here now is into some issues concerning the antebellum period. Now, before we do that, I want to give you a quick heads up on what you need to know or prepare for the coming quiz this Tuesday. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. What was the antebellum before the Civil War?
Before the War.
Before the Civil War.
We're talking about the period of time from 1816 to 1860, the antebellum period.
Oh, okay.
The antebellum period. So what do you need to know for the quiz? everything that we covered between 1789 and 1850. Are there any questions? Can't make it any easier for you, can I? Yes, I can.
Yeah.
You know the three branches of the government? Becca, what are they? You've got it, okay? If anybody has any questions about three branches of the federal government, talk to Becca. Okay? What are the first 10 amendments of the United States Constitution called? Audrey. Bill of Rights.
Oh, I knew that.
Who is the first vice president of the United States? Who?
John.
What does the Treaty of Ghent do?
Oh no.
What?
Stop.
Did it end the war?
Got it.
Joshua, what is that?
What is?
Why?
Give me another name for the second war for independence.
The war of
1812.
Joshua's got it.
The war.
Okay, listen. You know, the reason you guys struggle on your tests and quizzes is you don't sit close enough to Joshua. If you sat close enough to Joshua, you'd probably able to absorb some of those intelligence views that he emanates.
It's
other than that.
I'm serious.
Wait, what was the answer?
Joshua will tell.
What was
it? What's the Hartford Convention?
I said that.
Hartford Convention. Write it down. Okay, you got it. Oh, yeah.
That's where the Federalists were together and got mad at the way.
And got what? I'm sorry.
And got mad at the Democrats, Republicans.
Is it the Hartford Convention?
And they want to limit the power of Congress so they leave otherwise.
Okay. All right, Daniel's pretty. You're close enough. You darn close to the
Daniel, that was the Hartford Convention.
That's the Hartford
what
Convention.
What it was about? What
can you say it again in easier words?
If I give me a critical point that President Washington makes in his farewell address.
Oh, she's
yes, and. That's good. Any others? Good. I'm gonna make you guys crack the spine on your textbook.
Wait, what piece of the question again?
I diligently looked for something that might be like a comic book version of U.S. American history. I couldn't find it.
No,
I
can find anything that won't have.
Okay, Washington's farewell address. It's addressed, it's in your textbook. Jake Treaty, tell me about it. Jake Treaty. Okay, write it down. How about the Pinckney Treaty? Write it down.
The what
treaty? I can say about the Jake Treaty.
Pinckney?
Oh, all right, go ahead, Andrew.
It was in 1794. The British agreed to evacuate Northwest Territory. The U.S. and Britain exchanged favored nation status. Small U.S. ships allowed to trade with English colonies. U.S. merchants to be reimbursed for losses, and the U.S. would pay for pre-revolution debt. And the Senate approved in 1795.
So basically, what?
I don't know. I just said.
All right. Well, in that case, you're going to have to figure. Either remember all that or remember what's really important about the Jay Treaty. What's really critical?
No compensation for lost slaves.
Andrew got the specifics down, but there's something else that's important about the Jay Treaty.
Oh, we postponed the war of England by 18 years.
Okay, if you don't know the answer, Dr. Chloe.
Close it again.
We
postponed the war with England by 18 years.
I'll
lead
it up just for that.
Right.
Because it's on the war.
All right. Everybody already wrote down the Pinckney Treaty.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Tell me about the Revolution of 1800. Okay, write it down. I say Marbury v. Madison, and everybody does what?
Judicial review!
Okay, very good.
Yeah!
Court of Discovery, what was it?
What is that?
Court of Discovery.
Oh, it's the Madison Pirate Expedition.
The inside of an apple, no. Court of... Lewis and Clark Expedition, very good.
Lewis and Clark Expedition.
Yes.
Yes.
So what was the Chesapeake Affair?
Oh!
We said something about
the Chesapeake.
Daniel.
Oh, really?
Got it. Okay, if you don't know the answer, talk to Daniel.
Daniel.
Chesapeake. Isn't that a lot of Chesapeake?
We'll talk about it. What are the first two national political parties in 1794?
Democratic and Federalist.
Say it, okay, well, I think I got, Okay, all right, good.
Wait, can you say it again, I said I'm here.
Okay, talk to...
Democratic and Republican.
What's the quasi-war?
Oh, no.
Quasi-war. Go ahead, Becca. Well, the arrow went in the general direction, but you gotta hit the target to get credit. Sebastian?
An unofficial naval war between the U.S. and France.
That's it. Okay. That's it. All right. Four components of Hamilton's economic plan.
Oh, I wrote it down.
That's okay. If you wrote it down, you got it, okay? Who knows the Sedition Act?
What? No. How do you spell that?
The Sedition Act.
S-E-D-I-T-A.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Daniel knows it. Peter knows it. Who knows it?
Yeah.
So
I'm not going
to
say anything.
Wait. Let Daniel talk.
Daniel, go ahead.
Daniel, go. Take it away.
Bible of slander against governmental officials.
Got it. Good.
Okay,
what is that?
For
2 years.
2 years. You said vile and
2 years. Okay, very good.
What?
Whiskey Rebellion?
Whiskey
Rebellion?
Level what?
Whiskey Rebellion.
Wait, is it
where?
When Pagan went on the rampage and started busting up bars. You remember doing it? Okay, right. What is the significance of the Whiskey Rebellion? What's that? Well, the excise tax is what we're talking about. Yeah, yes. Western farmers didn't like that. Yeah, it's a protest against the excise tax. What else?
First rebellion.
Okay, it's first rebellion. It's let's carry that. Carry it a little further down the line. Well, okay.
First
tax rebellion. Well, it's a tax rebellion. I'm looking for the... No, you guys are still falling short of the goal. The important point here is this is going to be the first challenge to federal authority. Okay. Yeah, it's a tax revolt. It's tax rebellion. It is a significant episode in the time of the early republic. But what makes this all important is Americans are rising up and challenging the authority of the federal government to levy this tax. Okay. Whiskey, go. Excise tax. Excise tax. Okay. All right. Everybody got that? Okay. Who's the second smartest person in the class?
Hope Tool.
Okay, Hope.
Oh no, why do I say that?
Okay, well, I want you to name a future state that we get out of Louisiana Purchase.
Montana. Sorry.
3 seconds.
I got one.
One. Time. Kansas, I'll take it. Sophie.
Oh, Louisiana.
Louisiana.
I'm so
sorry. What? Nebraska, I'll take it. Peter.
I'll say Texas.
Missouri, I'll take it.
Can I say something?
Here. What?
Montana.
Got it. I'll take
it.
Isn't it
what? Oh, you're taking two. North and South. Know? Okay. Good. Sebastian.
Iowa.
No, not right. Hold that dot. Daniel.
Iowa.
Iowa. I'll take it.
Give me this, Brad.
No, we already got Nebraska.
Oklahoma.
Oklahoma, okay.
I wasn't here to talk about the Louisiana purchases.
This is Indiana purchases. Arkansas. I could have thrown in Colorado, Canada. Wait, Sebastian. Name a state, name a state that comes out of the Northwest Territory. Ohio. Give me another one, Becca. 3 seconds, what?
Argalon.
Caitlin. Illinois, I'll take it. Indiana, I'll take it. Brady. We got Ohio, Indiana, Illinois. Two more.
Put your hand down, Jack.
Michigan, I'll take it. One more. Who haven't I picked on? Paige.
No, don't, I'm gonna answer it not.
I know, it's a village in Arkansas.
Wow.
Arkansas. It's okay.
Is that?
All right, Peter.
Michigan.
We got Michigan.
Wyoming.
Illinois.
Oh, perfect.
I can't be in this class anymore.
One more. Okay, work on it.
What happened to this?
China. I just got.
Oh.
Give me the 100 already.
Literally YJ.
Wait, what'd you say?
All right, give me consent. All right.
I want to see where I'm losing.
Okay, no pressure, no pressure. Who are we gonna pick up? Okay, Chloe, first I saw. Okay, you're it. I want you to name a state that's added to the Union before 1800.
Please don't ask me. I do not.
What? Josh.
North Carolina.
No, no, no.
Oh.
You can't count the 13 because they're already part of the Union.
Oh.
Daniel. Kentucky, I'll take it.
New Hampshire, not New, New Hampshire.
Why are you listening to him?
I was just staring at the tab.
He was just saying.
I'm not even saying Tennessee.
It was Egypt.
It is.
You literally told me to say Wyoming.
Tennessee, Kentucky. No, we already got Kentucky. Tennessee.
Can I ask a question?
One more.
I wanna say Wyoming, but Wyoming's false.
Vermont, very good.
I was gonna say.
Yes, I still got it.
Okay, guys, there's your little tip. What are you gonna have? We're gonna have fill in, just, you know, short answer question. And I think it's something like 20, 25 multiple choice questions. Up, down, in and out. It's an easy test, okay?
Easy quiz?
Or quiz. It's an easy quiz, okay? Okay?
When is Wyoming a clue?
I don't understand it all.
Would you guys feel better if I played the funeral march when you take it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, all right.
I feel like it's like a wedding song.
Why?
We're into the antebellum here. This is going to be a time, very briefly, between 1816 and 1824, a period of time that is mentioned in your textbook that is often referred to as the era of good feelings. The Federalist Party is fading away by 1820. They are gone. So essentially, between 1820 and 1824, there's only going to be one national political party, and they're going to identify themselves as National Republicans. In other words, all Americans are politically aligned. We're all getting along with each other. Everybody feels good about themselves. Remember, we didn't lose the war, therefore we won. We're victorious, we're patriotic, we're Americans. We're expanding further to the West. Life is good. On the heels of that, we get the introduction to what is referred to as the Monroe Doctrine. I want you to understand some of the events that quickly lead to the proclamation of the Monroe Doctrine and its importance in U.S. foreign policy. Now, what happens is, when the Napoleonic Wars come to an end, the Congress of Vienna, under the leadership of Prince von Metternich from Austria, gets all of the European nations together and says, look, guys, we've got to come up with a way to prevent another devastating European conflict such as we've just experienced with Napoleon. For the previous 20 years, essentially what's happened is Europe has been engulfed in one war after another.
we don't want this to happen again. And they have reached the conclusion that the way to avoid a future conflict is to achieve a balance of power in Europe. The concern was that what had happened is, by the late 18th century, France had gotten a little too powerful and therefore had that incentive to try and dominate the rest of Europe. And they failed. So what the Congress of Vienna is setting out to do is create a level playing field so that nobody feels more powerful than the other one. And if that happens, then we're not going to have any wars. In other words, Andrew's not going to start anything because he knows that Peter is as strong as him, and Andrew doesn't want to get a bloody nose, so he's not going to pick a fight with Peter, okay? In the past, Andrew might have felt, I'm tougher than Peter, I can bloody his hand before he can even touch him. But now we're going to create this balance of power, and you don't have that confidence anymore, okay? That's what we're doing in Europe. It's during the Napoleonic Wars that many of the Latin American countries, from Mexico all the way down to Chile and Argentina, essentially secure their independence from Spain. And Spain essentially loses its empire in the New World. They'll retain a few holdings in the Caribbean, as will the French. But essentially, both nations have lost large chunks of their overseas empire during the Napoleonic Wars. What the Congress of Vienna has now concluded is Spain and France need to rebuild their empire to maintain this balance of power in Europe. And so they essentially give a green light to Spain and France to go ahead and reclaim their lost colonies. One player in this European conference that is unhappy with this arrangement is going to be Great Britain. Why? Because during the Napoleonic Wars, Great Britain had established trade relations with these new Latin American republics. And it's going to be bad business for Great Britain if they lose these trade contacts. Remember, we talked about this whole idea of mercantilism. And what is happening now is if Spain gets its old colonies back, Spain's going to shut the water off in any trade, say, for example, between Mexico and England. And that would be bad for the English economy. So England's not in favor of these European nations getting colonies in the New World or regaining their lost colonies, okay? Now, for reasons that we don't have time to go into, England decided to get a partner. And so they turned to the United States of America and said, how would you guys like to join us in issuing a joint proclamation to all the world, telling the entire world to stay out of the Western Hemisphere. James Monroe, who was president at the time, says, wow, this is cool, this is a great idea. I want you to understand what's going on in his mind now. We're talking about the greatest nation in the world, most powerful nation in the world, turning to the United States, saying, how would you like to be our partner? Oh, got it. Okay, so what's your sport, Pepe?
Swimming.
Huh?
Swimming.
Swimming, okay.
I'm a drag.
So what happens is, I can't even think of anything. I don't remember his long spits, but there's someone more contemporary than that.
Michael Phelps.
That's it. So Michael Phelps calls Becca at home on the phone. Says, Becca, how would you like to be on my team? Yeah, this is your shot at the Olympics. Got it. Becca's feeling pretty good about this, huh? I mean, we're talking about a prominent national, international figure, sports figure, who is asking Becca to be on his swim team. I mean, you can't do better than that. I mean, how many people from Trinity are going to get that kind of a phone call? And you only one. Got it? You're feeling pretty good about you. This is how Monroe is feeling about this call from Great Britain. Everybody likes this idea.
except James Monroe's Secretary of State, John Quincy Adams. John Quincy Adams says this is not a good idea. We should not do this, quote, lest we appear to be a cockboat in the wake of a British man of war. What the heck does that mean? A cockboat is a small little rowboat. That's it. Little rowboat. And it's going to look like the United States is standing in this rowboat being towed by a bottle ship. And Beckett is there saying, I'm number one. That's what he means. We're going to look kind of stupid, aren't we? It's really the Royal Navy that is number one. We're just going along for the ride. Mark Spitz is just invited back to Ireland. I think he's got to get a token female or someone from Virginia to be on the team. And he just went through the phone record and said, I'm a girl. Okay. You know, so now Becca is thinking she's number one, when in truth, she just happened to be, you know, on the call list or something. John Quincy Adams says, this is a bad idea. Sorry. James Monroe listened and said, well, what do you think we should do? And John Quincy Adams said, let's issue our own proclamation. We'll go it alone. That's what they did. They issued their own proclamation. Red Star. Now, this material is not going to be on the quiz on Tuesday, but it's very probable that you're going to see it in a future assessment. Winky, winky. He persuades James Monroe to do this, and so in an address to Congress in December 1823, James Monroe proposes what later is going to become known as the Monroe Doctrine. First, the United States of America will not interfere with any existing European colonies. In other words, we're not going to interfere with Spanish claim on Cuba because Spain still holds Cuba. We're not going to interfere with French Guiana because the French already still have Guiana. We're not going to get them. So we're not going to interfere with any existing European colonies in the Western Hemisphere. But we will not tolerate the subjugation of newly independent republics. In other words, Spain don't plan on coming back here to take over Mexico or Peru or Argentina. It's a no-no. We're not going to let you do that. Neither will we tolerate any Europeans coming over to the Western Hemisphere and carving out their own little territories. We're not going to permit France to land on the north side of the South American continent and grab some jungle in Brazil and some jungle in Venezuela and say this is a new colony that belongs to us. No new colonies. There are no new European colonies in the New World. And fourth, the United States of America is going to stay out of European affairs. What's that? It means you stay out of America, and America will stay away from you. You play in your backyard, you play in our backyard. Okay? This is the introduction, incidentally, of American isolationism, or at least the formalization. Okay? This is why this becomes essentially the cornerstone for isolationism. 100 years in which Americans are going to say, look, we've already promised we're not going to play in other people's backyards. And we expect you guys to extend that same courtesy to us. Okay? That's the Monroe Doctrine. So what's going to be the reaction from the European nations? What do you think? United States of America. Who the heck are they to tell us what we can and cannot do? I'm serious. So Spain and France are essentially very unhappy with the United States. Someone's going to be a little confused by what the Americans have just done. Who's that? The British. Yeah. Hey, we just invited you to partner with us to do this, and now you're going to go alone? I don't get it. Why? You guys can't stop France and Spain by yourself, right? So why did we do this? To assert our independence and essentially claim that we are now the big brother in the Western Hemisphere. So what ends up happening is we issued this proclamation, the Monroe Doctrine, and what did the European nations do about it? Did they establish any colonies in the New World? Did they establish any new colonies? No. Did they retake any of their old colonies? Did they? Yes. No, very good. They didn't reestablish, they didn't take back their old colonies. They didn't establish new colonies. Why? Because what happens is, go back to Becca, this is Becca and Becca. What happens is, when Becca jumps up and on top of her desk and springs to the top of her lungs, I can beat any one of you guys with one hand tied behind my back, my eyes closed. Come on, bring it on. You know, guys, let's see, I should have picked a question. Well, it's Becca. Becca does this, and what ends up happening is some of you guys are thinking, I don't know, no. I think I could beat her with her one arm tied behind her back and her eyes closed, but it must be a trick. What does she know that I don't know? What has she got that I don't have? I mean, what has she got in her other hand? A 357 Magnum or something? Is she peeking or her closed eye? What's the trick? And the sense of what's going to happen is the European nations are going to scratch their head saying, maybe these Americans know something we don't know. They may be a little angry that they've done it, that we have done this in the laboratory. They're also scratching their head. Maybe these guys are maybe a bit stronger or bigger or better than we give them credit for being. Okay. Tough stuff. But there's something else that's perhaps even more practical in all of this. When Becca stands up in that little cockboat, that little dinghy, that little rowboat out there in the ocean and says, I am the toughest thing on the block, what do the European nations really see? What's that big shadow that's hanging over them? Say it. It's a British man of war. Even though the United States is claiming credit for keeping the Europeans out, the bottom line is Spain and France aren't going to try and cross the Atlantic Ocean and tangle with the Royal Navy to get their colonies back. Because it's the Royal Navy, not you and your little rowboat, that's keeping these guys away. And why is the Royal Navy willing to do this? Because England wants to preserve those trade relations with these new Latin American republics. Got it? But we are Americans, and what do we conclude? We're the best. We scared them off. Europe is now going to play the game by our tune. This is a derivative of our lesson learned from the War of 1812. We didn't lose, therefore we won. Now what's happened is we've stared down all of Europe and said, you keep out of the Western Hemisphere, and they did. Huh? Are we powerful? Are we great? Are we good? Huh? Got it? This is Monroe Doctrine, guys. It is going to set the tone for American foreign policy for the next 200 years. And I already talked about the media. In 1836, what's going to happen is we're going to invoke the Monroe's Doctrine when we're dealing with the Republic of Texas, because there were fears that England might try and separate Texas from its bonds with the United States. We will actually formally give it a name and call it the Monroe Doctrine and essentially proclaim it as a cornerstone of U.S. foreign policy during the Polk administration. Grant will extend the doctrine only. Theodore Roosevelt will take Monroe's Doctrine and he'll add a corollary to it, the Roosevelt corollary, in which the United States is going to get personally involved in Latin American affairs.
We'll talk more about that in a second. It'll be invoked as Cold War doctrine as well. What do I want you to remember about the doctrine? Here's the showstopper of the significance of the Monroe Doctrine. The Monroe Doctrine represents the quintessential example of post-war 1812 nationalism. The country is young, united, and focused on expansion. And we honestly believe we're the best thing to come along since sliced bread. This is nationalism, raw nationalism. We took the solo course in proclaiming the Monroe Doctrine because we honestly believed it. We believe that we have the power and the authority to do this. It's going to reinforce this illusion of isolationism. We cannot depend upon the Atlantic Ocean and the Pacific Ocean to protect us as natural barriers for our national security. It's going to work until we get to grow up. It's going to raise the standard of an independent American foreign policy, and this is something that's going to bedevil us for almost the next 200 years. Guys, get over this nonsense that these talking heads say on ABC, CBS, NBC News, or to read about the papers in the Washington Post or the New York Times. The United States, once again, has decided to do something independent of all of the other nations in the world. Guys, that is so American. It would be a contradiction for us. It would be a very uncomfortable experience for us if we did it otherwise. It's just characteristic of the United States of America to engage in independent actions in U.S. foreign policy. This is the first of these independent actions. And of course, it's still invoked as a basic component of U.S. foreign policy. Opportunity, however, to highlight some of the big ticket items. Monroe Doctrine is going to be one in foreign policy. The tariff of abominations is going to be door number two. When we talk about the tariff of abominations, I want you to understand what we're talking about with tariffs and how quickly this spins out of control and how it's going to encourage this sectional split that takes place between the North and the South. Star. Oh. Please keep in mind that a tariff is a tax. It is an indirect tax. Okay? We levy tariffs for a number of reasons. We can use any one or all of these reasons when we levy a tariff. Sometimes what we want to do is discourage foreign competition. We just don't want Japanese-made cars coming to the United States, and so we impose a tariff, a special tax or customs duty, on Toyotas that are made in Japan. We want to generate some national income or revenue. And this is going to be the criteria for establishing a tariff originally. Remember, one of the basic components of Hamilton's economic plan is to have a small national debt and fund it with excise taxes and customs duties, a tariff. In other words, we're going to collect a tariff from imported goods to help pay off our national debt. From 1790 to 1914,
the principal source of income for the federal government was the tariff. We may want to encourage domestic production. In other words, if there's a foreign operation that produces a product, an industrialized or sometimes even an agricultural product that we can develop here in the United States, we may want to encourage domestic production of that particular product. And the way to encourage that production is to discourage importing the same item from another country. And finally, sometimes we just want to punish another country. For instance, we've done it to Japan, we've done it to China. In other words, we're unhappy with the way China, say, produces inexpensive goods. They're subsidized by the government, and then they ship them over here and dump them on the market in the United States, which depresses our economy because Americans go out and buy the cheaper goods. So what we decide to do is we're going to punish China for doing this by arbitrarily raising the tariff on any imported goods coming from China. All right. Now, how does this work? This is we'll make this the pick on Becca today. We'll use Becca's. Okay, you're on deck. Okay. What we've got is, let's say Becca comes up with this great idea. She's going to have a shoe factory in Boston, Massachusetts. We're going to have Becca Shoes, and her vision is to put everybody in Becca Shoes. And so she's going to produce 10,000 pairs of shoes a month. For that kind of an industrial production, however, you're going to need a big factory. You're going to have to buy your initial supplies. You're going to have a payroll issue with all of your employees. So the first thing you have to do is get a loan from? No, yeah. You need $100,000. Where are you going to get the money? Not the Bank of America. Bank of what? Not the Bank of America. Bank of the United States, okay? So Becca's going to take out a loan from the Bank of the United States. This is exactly what Hamilton wants Becca to do, okay? Because it's good for the economy, the national economy. So now she's in a position to produce Becca shoes from Boston, Massachusetts. The problem is that over in England, Lord Farquaad is producing the same kind of shoes, and he's charging half the price. Why? Because he doesn't have the startup expenses, he's a well-established business, and he's just smoking. So, Chloe, you have the option of buying a pair of Becca shoes for $10 a pair, or you can buy the same kind of shoes from Lord Farquaad for $5 a pair. Which one are you going to buy? Of course. Got it? Which isn't going to do your business any good. No one's going to buy your shoe. But what the United States wants to do is encourage this shoe industry in the United States. So we're going to discourage people from buying Lord Farquaad shoes. So just these are extreme numbers, but just to keep the math simple and the illustration as well, we'll just impose a 100% tariff on Lord Farquaad shoes, or all shoes coming from Britain. Okay. So now, Chloe, you have the option of buying Lord Farquaad shoes made in England for $10 a pair, or you can buy American for $10 a pair and get Becca shoes. Which one are you going to buy? Good American. Okay, it's the patriotic duty. Buy American. Got it? Okay. Now, we have to take a brief detour here. I want you to understand one of the handicaps of this tariff. As most of you probably don't know, but in this, for the sake of this illustration, I know Becca is greedy and anxious to make her first $1 million before the end of next year. So, yeah, you're looking to tell. She's looking for it. So what is Becca going to do? Becca raises the price
price of her shoes to $15 a pair. Now, before it comes time for Chloe to buy a pair of shoes, Becca goes to her congressman and says, sir, you realize that Ford Fauquat is selling his shoes for less than mine. And if something isn't done about that, I may have to curtail my production, which means laying off some of my workers, which means I'll have unemployed people in Boston. And unemployed people are not tacky workers. Winky, winky. I ain't stupid. So I write up the bill that increases the tariff on Lord Fauquat shoes again. So now the price of Lord Fauquat shoes is $15 a pair, and Becca shoes are $15 a pair. So Chloe is gonna buy Becca shoes. See how this works? And Becca, she just keeps up on the price all the time. Do your production costs go up? No. Does your labor costs go up? No. You just keep on arbitrarily raising your price because the politicians in Congress don't want to hurt the national economy. They don't want to see anybody go under in America, so they keep on raising import fees for these English goods. Oh.
Okay, so I'm a little confused because when in England the prices were $10 and her shoes were $15, she's like, Lord Fauquat has like a lower price than me, she comes to you and talks to you, what can you do about that?
I can write a bill in Congress that raises the tariff on English shoes.
Okay, that makes sense.
To price them, essentially, price them out of the market so that she can stay in the market.
Oh, got it.
Got it? Okay. Now, what happens to the South? Let's say Chloe is, we've used Chloe in Britain, let's go to Audrey. Audrey lives in the South, down there in Charleston. Okay. You need a new pair of shoes.
Yeah, you do.
No. Okay. Audrey needs a new pair of shoes. Okay. Now, are you going to pay $10 for Lord Fauquat? We've already imposed one tariff. Are you willing to pay $10 a pair for Lord Fauquat shoes, or do you want to buy American shoes for $10 a pair? Yeah, you would like to do that, but it doesn't. But Becca's not going to charge you $10, is she? Why? Because she has shipping costs. She's got to ship her goods from Boston down to Charleston, and that's going to cost a couple of dollars more. Bummer, man. So now you have to pay $12 for Becca's shoes, or $10 for Lord Fauquat shoes. Which one do you want to buy? And Becca is going to go back to Congress and say, this is another reason why you need to raise the tariff. So Congress raises it and makes it 15 and 15, but the catch is, it's still going to be an extra $2 to ship Becca's shoes down to Charleston. So it's $17 for a pair of Becca's shoes, and now it's $15 for Lord Fauquat shoes. So which one's you going to buy, Audrey? $15 for Lord Fauquat shoes, or $17 for Becca's shoes? Becca, buy the Lord Fauquat shoes. So what's Becca going to do? And? You better get some protection, right? Come to your favorite congressman and remind him that unhappy, unemployed workers are not happy voters. Got it? And now, okay, we got a question. Go ahead, Al. Well, because it, well, why isn't there? Well, the total, I'm just doing a package deal. It's $15 a pair, even when you raise your price, it's still $15 a pair because you make it in Boston and Chloe's in Boston, okay? But to ship it from Boston to Charleston, it's gonna cost some money. Connor.
Why are Becca's shoes raising the price?
She's greedy. But that's it. You know, she right. Hey, I got a cash cow here, and I got a politician who wants to stay in office. Seriously. Guys, this is what's going on even as I speak. Why do your taxes keep going up? Because politicians keep on promising anything to anybody to get elected. It's the people that don't get elected that you ought to look favorably upon, because they're more than likely the ones who aren't going to raise your taxes. But they're also not going to cobble special interest in the process. Now, here's the problem. Audrey is really ticked off because she could be getting Lord Fauquat shoes for $5 a pair if it wasn't for the tariff. Now she's paying as much as $17 a pair for Becca shoes from Boston. So what's Audrey's opinion of the tariff? Say it, Hope.
Not good.
Not good. She doesn't like it. Guys, this is what's contributing to this sectional crisis, this separation between the North and the South. Because what Southerners are saying is, no fair. We are favoring the commercial, industrial interests of the North so that people like Becca can make $1 zillion. And we Southerners have to foot the bill. Audrey is underwriting her greed and her expenses. Chloe just happens to be there in the right place, and you get stuck with the bill too. But it's Audrey who feels like she's paying top dollar. She could get the same pair of shoes for $5, but now she's got to pay more than 3 times that to get the similar product, and because she has to buy American. Well, she doesn't have to, but I mean, this is still going to be the cheaper option. See what happens? This is what John C. Calhoun is going to refer to as the terror of abominations. I already mentioned that. Now, in this case, what's happened is the average cost of imported goods has risen by 50%. What further exacerbates this problem is most American exports are coming from the South, cotton. So Audrey is contributing to the good of the national economy and national income with all of the cotton that she is producing and sending overseas. But Audrey is also paying for a high tariff, an inordinate amount of expenses to sustain or underwrite Becca's greed. And they're calling this a tariff of abominations. And so what happens is John C. Calhoun goes to the South Carolina legislature and says South Carolina has the right to nullify this federal law, declare it void in South Carolina. It doesn't apply here. Now, let's back up. Draw your lessons from the past. Have we encountered nullification before? Yes. Where? Two separate episodes come up with nullification. It's that weed in your front lawn that just will not die. Now, there's no Bank of America. No, not the Bank of the United States. They try to kill the Bank of the United States, but that's not. That's not enough notification issue. The Alien and Sedition Act, Kentucky and Virginia resolutions, 1798. Thomas Jefferson and James Madison authored the two resolutions for these two state legislatures in which the Kentucky and Virginia state legislatures say that they have the right to nullify federal law. Alien Sedition Acts don't apply within our state boundaries. Then it comes up again in the Hartford Convention, in which the Federalists say, we want the right to essentially nullify a
declaration of war. We want to opt out and not be players in a war. And now nullification pops up in South Carolina. What would be the consequences of South Carolina, of South Carolina's action, if they could nullify the tariff? What would be the price of Ward Fauquat shoes in Charleston, South Carolina, if the tariff were nullified? Daniel?
$5.
What's going to be the effect on the national economy? Come on, carry it further. What's going to happen?
You're buying imports rather than
estimated. We're not collecting any tariffs, so the federal government won't get any money, at least out of Charleston. And where the heck do you think Ward Fauquat's going to ship all of his shoes? To Charleston, where he doesn't have to pay any import fees. Okay. Now all of a sudden, Becca's going to lose more money because people are going to buy shoes from Charleston, South Carolina. Southern industry is going to skyrocket. Becca is going to suffer for this, probably have to curtail her operations. She's going to get some unemployed workers and they become unhappy voters. And I am now looking at other career possibilities on the eve of the next election. We got to stop this sucker. Now what happens is Henry Clay, the great compromiser, good name, you want to write that down. Henry Clay, the great compromiser. Brilliant man. Undervalued American statesman. Henry Clay steps into the middle of this and he brokers a deal. The reason Henry Clay's got to get in the middle of this is we are this close to having a civil war in 1832. John C. Calhoun pushes through a resolution of nullification and the South Carolina legislature approves the legislation. So Andrew Jackson, as President of the United States, goes to Congress and says, I need authority to deal with states that do not enforce federal law. Congress gives him that authority in what is called the Force Bill. The Force Bill of 1833 says, you can use the United States Army to suppress any rebellion in the country and enforce all federal law. Hugs and kisses, Congress. Now, equipped with this legislation, Andrew Jackson stares down John C. Calhoun in South Carolina and says, I got authorization from Congress and I got an army. Okay. John C. Calhoun locked his heels and said, big deal. Henry Clay gets in the middle of it and says, guys, chill out. We can compromise on this issue. And he negotiates a compromise that is going to lower the tariff significantly. It'll be over a period of time. By 1842, the tariff will be lowered to 20, the average of 20% on imports. Question?
Wait, so I'm a little confused of why, like, he would want to lower the tariff. Like, I understand it's more money for everyone.
Why Calhoun?
Why Clay wanted to lower the tariff.
Clay is willing to see the tariffs lower because he recognizes that the South really does have a legitimate concern. He recognizes, however, that we've got to maintain some kind of a tariff to give Becca a fair chance at competing with Ward Fauquat. So he's trying to achieve some balance here. And quite honestly, the other thing that Henry Clay is doing is he's trying to preserve the Union, keep everything intact. All right? So what ends up happening? Tariff is going to become a recurring issue in the country from 1789 to 1860. And for the latter half of the 19th century, the tariff will be a question. It's hard for us to imagine this, but voters really got energized and excited about the tariff question. The stuff that I just talked about, people really got excited about back in those days. But it clearly is going to be a significant wedge that will separate the North South and ultimately contribute to this sectional crisis and eventually the Civil War.
remember that this is going to be only one of several divisive issues in our republic. Because the next one is going to be second bank in the United States. Comments, questions, or complaints? What's that?
A complaint about the chapel.
That's correct. Well, as soon as you jump up and say, I have a complaint, then I'll say, go see the chapel. All right. We'll see you on Tuesday. We'll see you on Tuesday. We'll do the quiz, and then we'll pick up the second.
I don't put your mouth in my hand.